coding, here we go again. Bun, deci, bine ați venit, Hristos a înviat, v-ați distrat în vacanță, v-ați odihnit, totul bine? Daniel 512, să... frate, deci ajungem, când te-am promovat, bă?
Nu, tanca m-a promovat.
Taică tot.
Tanca, colegul.
Ok, bine. Dar ce ești acum, locotenent?
Probabil.
Când eram mic, bunicul meu mă învăța rancurile, era ziua marinei și mi-a arătat tresele de la aia și îmi zicea care îi, ce îi, știi? Șmecher, the good old days. Bun, hai să recapitulăm un pic cine ce-și amintește, da? Și începem cu Andreea. Despre ce am vorbit înainte de vacanță?
Păi înainte de vacanță am vorbit despre algoritmi genetici și cum să implementăm și am început să facem și NC pentru o problemă.
Algoritmi genetici? Că ultima dată am făcut cu rețele neuronale, cu perceptronul.
Înainte? Am crezut că tot cam ce am făcut înainte.
A, nu, zic cel mai recent, deci...
Da, alea, atunci alea.
No, bun, și din astea, ce poți să-mi zici că ți-amintești? Facem un pic de recapitulare că să intrăm după aia tare în pita. Încep, da, numai începe să vorbești că după aia întreb și pe altcineva, da? Hai să facem așa un pic de refreshing de memory, ok?
Păi, mi-amintesc că aveam nevoie de mai mulți neuroni.
Și am plecat de la unul singur. Ca să rezolvăm ce probleme poți rezolva cu un singur neuron. Hai că începem de aici.
Cred că am început să încercăm să facem cu operația de AND.
Așa.
Și pentru aia...
Bun, dar la cazul general, ce fel de probleme se pot rezolva bine? Sau pot să antrenez un simplu perceptron ca să le rezolve? Hai să începem de aici, cazul simplu, da? Oricine poate să zică. Cum se numește clasa mare de probleme care poate să fie rezolvată de un singur perceptron?
Vă zici, Brighi, probleme binare, nu știu dacă ai văzut.
Așa, probleme binare sunt... Ce înseamnă probleme binare?
Care au ca variantă de răspuns doar adevărat sau fals?
Bun, dar avem, până una alta, avem două clase mari de probleme pe care le putem rezolva. Care sunt alea? Una este clasificare și alta este... Ce înseamnă fiecare? Cine poate să-mi zică? Așa, Loredana. Ok, Loredana. Nu-ți merge microfonul? Ok. Gabi, zi-mi tu, ce presupune clasificarea? Clasificare binară, să zicem. Gabi. Ok, thank you, Loredana, I forgot we should speak English. That's correct. Right, so I'm flipping my switch to English now. Alexander, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
What does binary classification mean? It's what Harapalb had to do, right? Do you guys remember? The story of Harapalb. He had to like discern the grains of wheat from, nu știu cum se zice, neghină în engleză. Right? Știe careva cum se zice neghină?
Man, nici nu știu ce înseamnă aia în română.
Păi e ceva plantă, nașpa, care crește în lanul de grâu și atunci când se harvestuiește grâu, normal că nu o să poți să le desfaci grâu de neghină și așa că în hangare... Când ai și bobe de grâu, dar ai și de chestie nașpa, știi? Înțelegi ce zic?
Da.
Okay. So, the idea is that usually when we have to tackle some real life problems, you need to classify a set of instances, right? So, let's remember, Andrea.
Da.
Let's remember what was the input for a problem in the case of machine learning. What did we have for input?
Desk.
I'm sorry? Andrea?
Nu mi amintesc.
Da, ok, don't have to remember, you just have to, like, tell me, what do you think we have as input? Which will lead us to something that I will give you as an assignment, ok? So, it all starts with the data, Paula. O ieși Paula deja?
Oare poți să dai stream și pe Discord?
Ah, yeah, sure.
Mersi.
Am uitat de asta, da. Thanks. Paula! Donde sta Paula? U etu Paula? Ok. Tor, can you tell me a little bit about the input data for machine learning?
It's a set of a certain type of data that you need.
So how did we call?
You also have a weight.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the input here. We haven't reached the weights part yet. So
it's one or zero?
No. I mean, like, what goes into a system of machine learning system? So you need to regard the machine learning system as a black box, right? So this is the machine learning algorithm here. What goes in and what comes out? That's the question. Tears. Merci, Alexander. Bă, dar unde-i Paula? Că doar era acum, a minute ago. Briggy, can you tell me? What goes in and what comes out? Okay. So tell me what goes in. It's cool. I'll be satisfied with what goes in. Okay, so it's a data set. So how does it look like, your data set? Usually. Andrei Tanca.
Da.
So, Briggy told us that we need to have a data set. Okay? So I'm gonna say a data set. It's true, but what is a data set? When you think of a data set, what's the shape it comes in?
A bag.
Huh? A bag?
Mm-hmm.
I got sunshine in a bag, I'm useless, but not for long, the future is coming on, is coming on. What do you mean a bag? Like, I don't care about the data structures now, I'm just...
Okay.
Looking at the data, let's say, you're a scientist, you've conducted a series of experiments, you received a couple of, I don't know, indicators for each experiment, like the pressure, the temperature, some other parameters you are following in your experiment.
Okay.
How are you going to store this?
In objects, structs, array of structs.
So, yeah, but... Yeah, I know. Don't tell me in terms of data structures. Just tell me, like, in real life, How do you think scientists get their represent their data after they conduct an experiment? You know, like chemists, biologists, huh?
They have functions.
Thank you. She says like in a file. Okay. Right. What kind of file?
CSVs, Excels.
Correct. So it's what are these type of data called? Like tabular data, right? So you have
data tables.
Data tables, right? You have tables. That's where I was going. Whoa, finally we got it. So usually the input data is just nothing but a table, right? That looks like this. Do you agree, guys? Are you paying attention, Andrea? Andrea, are you with us?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you remember now? Because we talked about this before. I'm just trying to rebrush your memory now, okay? Because we need to get into the groove, so to speak. Monica?
Yes.
So what do you store within the table?
Data.
Okay, thank you. Good answer. Pretty vague. Okay, what do you store on a specific column inside this?
So let's say we want first, let's take a column of IDs. We can take a column of strings, integers.
Of course. Do I like strings? What are strings? What type
An array of characters.
Yeah, okay. But from the point of view of data types, what type of data do they represent? If you have strings, what do the strings depict? Do you agree that they depict categories?
Yes.
Right? Because like usually it's labels, because people are good at labeling, right? You label each other every day. So it's like the name describes a group, right? You will have the same name multiple times on the same column, right? That depicts the particular instance is part of that category, right? So usually when you use strings, it means categorical data, right? Do you agree?
Yes.
What other type of data? So actually these data types map on the built-in data types that we have in programming. So you have arrays of characters, you have integer types, and you have real types, right? Do you agree? So the categorical data can either be represented by in string form or integers. And what is the other type of continuous, right? Represented as doubles and floats, floating points. Do you agree with this? Can you have something else in your data table rather than strings, integers, or floats?
Well, it eventually all comes down to one of these types. So even if you have like an object inside, it's still gonna be.
You need to serialize the object, and in order to serialize the object, you need to just hold the information that is within the attributes of the objects, which can be either other structures or these basic types, which boil down to ints, floats, and strings of characters. Do you agree, Colin?
Yes.
Okay, so it's simple, right? On each column, I have the same type of data, right? You have to agree it would be very bad to have on a given column to have some different data of different types, okay? That would be a mess. Do you agree?
Yes.
So let's assume Okay, so is it clear so far what we have on columns, Alexandra? Anna? Okay, let's continue with Anna. What do we have on a specific line then? Like this specific line, let's say. The information on a line refers to what?
Refers to an instance of an object?
Correct. Anna, do you agree?
Yes.
So why didn't you say it for before your colleague?
I was thinking, and then when I wanted to say it.
Okay. Okay, I'm not gonna make the "Are you running Java?" joke.
But she is.
Is she? Okay. So did you see my post from the about the ecological impact of programming languages?
Python was one of the worst, right?
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's not surprising, is it? Huh? Do you find it surprising that Python is very energy consuming?
No, not really. I think like the more recent a language is, the more inefficient it is, because it's made to be easier to use, not easier to run.
Yeah, I know. But look at Java, because I can't believe I'm saying something good about Java, man. But you know, once a language reaches its maturity, so to speak, or it goes beyond the hills in some aspects, it becomes more mature. Like you can see that Java, lo and behold, is trying to improve the performance, man. Like, we're living strange times indeed. So it will be the time of Python as well to do some, but it's still young, you know, it's still the young lion, so he won't have to change up until another lion comes along.
You have much to learn, young Padawan.
Indeed. Andrada, KMF, bienvenido a la fiesta. Ai urmărit ce am vorbit până acum? Okay. Karina. So what is an instance? Guys.
A product of a blueprint.
Yeah.
So to speak.
Yeah, I know. It's just like an object from a class, right?
Yes.
Karina, are you with us?
Most likely stored in a database.
Okay, but my CSV file is a database, so to speak.
Yes,
right?
It is.
It's a source of data persistency. Okay? So, in science, you... okay. At the beginning, you were using Excel. I mean, in Romania, probably people still use Excel, but... I was at a workshop in autumn, and there were some researchers from Cambridge there, and of course they have their clouds and they have their data obtaining mechanisms, which are way beyond our reach, you know what I'm saying? So, but at the end of the day, if you have a cloud of information or you have huge data in some Excels, it's still data, right? So you have to understand it from an abstract perspective. Although you have some instances stored in a cloud, or you have a table containing data in an Excel, at the end of the day, it's still data. You do the same thing with them. Do you agree?
Yes.
So that's, we need to look at the at things from an abstract perspective. Okay. So now this will get us closer to your next assignment for this class, okay? How many weeks do we have?
4 weeks left.
4 weeks?
Also, there is some news about the university year. The president just made a statement. no universities will open again until September, okay, with the exception of terminal years, which will come back to university. Hang on. Is it okay if I switch to Romanian for a bit? Because it's easier with this. Scrie doar elevii din an terminal vor reveni la școală după 2 iunie. Dar noi nu suntem elevi, noi suntem studenți și nu știu dacă se aplică.
Nu știu, vedem, ok? Ideea
e că fizic nu o să ne întoarcem.
Da, fizic
nu o să ne întoarcem. Fiecare facultate se hotărească momentan.
Ok, so the idea is as follows, ok? So you will have two assignments for this subject left, ok? So one is for machine learning and the other one is for deep learning, okay? So now we're going to focus about your assignment, which will be due 2 weeks from now, okay? Guys?
Okay.
So now the whole course of today is about conducting an machine learning, I don't know, approach to a real life problem, okay? So this is what I need from you to do at this course, okay? We're looking for trouble first, okay? First, we're gonna look for problems. And a great source of problems and data sets is this site. Have you heard of it?
No.
Guys?
No.
No.
Cool. I feel like the Mad Hatter now, leading you into the... What was that? Wonderland.
Down the rabbit hole.
Down the rabbit hole, yeah. So, you can see that this site holds competitions. For, like, they provide data sets for researchers to run their algorithms on. And some of them have prizes, right? And made the best man win. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, so your assignment starts with picking a data set that you will work on. So look for a topic that you're interested in. Look for, I don't know. They have here a lot of competitions based on various data sets and various problems from various domains, okay? You have to agree that the input data for a machine learning algorithm can come from each domain of study. Like, it can be geographical data, medical data, music, data concerning, I don't know, audio features, basketball, stats, sports, you name it. You want to bet on some team and you have to have all the results of the matches from UEFA Champions League or something, okay? So what I'm looking for here is for you to go search on this site and find a data set, okay? This is the first assignment. Do you agree with this? Because I want you to understand, yes, that everything comes from the data. Machine learning is born from the data. So if you have bad data, even the best of machine learning mechanism won't be of much help. Okay? Do you agree?
You post the link in the Discord server,
yeah,
so it's there.
Yeah, of course. So this is just one source of data, okay? This is like kind of a heap site for the finding data sets if you need one. But there are plenty of others, okay? So if you want to use another data set, you've already, I know, set your eyes on another data set, I'm fine with it, okay? But I need a data set that contains tabular data, okay? Because you will see here, look, for example, you have data sets like this one. No, this one. Okay. This is a very cool data set that was created by a former UBB teacher who is conducting very cool research on the matter of detecting fruits and stuff like that, okay? So look, usually a data set has a description of what it contains, and it has to explain all the headers of the table and all that, okay? Like a readme, okay? You can see, like a specification of the data within. So this particular data set contains, look, a buckload of images of fruit, but look, apples are like discerning to the type of apples and so on and so forth, okay? So it's a pretty cool data set, but I don't want you to, that's what I was saying, I don't want you to go for these types of data sets because this will be the input for the deep learning assignment that you will have to do for the final weeks, okay, guys? So you have 2 weeks for the assignment on artificial intelligence and 2 weeks for the assignment for deep learning, okay?
Okay.
Is it cool, guys?
Yeah.
Yeah, depends on what the assignment is.
Okay. It depends on what, man, I'm frightened now. What if I'm wrong? What if I hurt your feelings? Damn. Okay, so.
Like you would care.
Ooh.
Well, yeah, man, I mean, people keep telling me that, like, I'm the most insensitive prick that ever lived, but I don't think I am.
Have you heard of Hitler?
I'm not that talented in visual arts. Okay, so
your drawings are pretty nice, what can I say?
Yeah, okay. So what I want for you to search for this assignment is tabular data, okay? So once you find a data set, please contact me during this week so I can validate your data set, okay? So how will this gonna proceed? It's gonna be like on this Mate Info AI group here on this Discord, you will post your name and the link to the data set and I will validate it. Are you okay with that?
Okay,
good.
And can you tell us what would mean an invalid data set, so we know not to pick one?
An invalid data set will be a data set that has, I don't know, like this one, that has more abstract inputs like images or sounds or, I don't know, some other form of audiovisual content that is not a table with what we talked about, right? If it is a table that has either it should have a lot, so it's a good data set if it has a lot of columns on which you have floats, okay? I'll have to it should have at least some categorical data, but what we work with is numbers, so we will need a lot of floating point numbers, okay? Do you agree? Heyo.
Yeah, I guess. Yes. So, because I was thinking of doing something with fake news. I'm not sure if that, it sounds like it's complicated and something.
That's, it I sounds know, that, like that, it won't okay, fit. Okay, so, man, the idea is that this is just to open up your appetite, the machine learning part, okay? Because what you want to do, like the cool stuff, you will be able to do them with deep learning, okay? So, yeah, you can find, you can look for the next data set, the one for the second assignment for deep learning, while you look for this one, okay? But now for this particular machine learning task, I'm gonna need only some data sets that contain tables of data, okay? Do you understand?
Okay.
Guys, is it clear?
Ish, so you just want numbers?
Not only numbers, I mean, you'll have to have, okay, so I need tables of experiments or data or of some sort, you know? Let's see. Like, you need to search a little bit. Let's see what we've got here. How do we know? Okay, let's start from here. Because I said that we start from the data. How do I measure the quality of an input data set?
It probably should be like at least some form of uniform distribution, so not...
Oh man, up until we reach that, I mean, you clearly haven't seen real life data sets.
Oh, I guess first have only one data type in each column, so no string in IDs and stuff like that.
Again, you have a high quality expectation of what we'll have, man. I mean, you're going to be so disappointed of some data sets. So hear me out.
First of all, full words.
How about if it misses data, you know? Like, for example, I did research on archaeological, osteological remains, means bones from archaeological sites, okay? So the idea was that you don't find the whole skeleton, right? So you don't find just one femur and one phalange and that's it, and the others for that particular instance, which is that dead guy from 5,000 years ago, you only have two values and the others are not a number or something, you know what I'm saying? So you have to agree that the data that you're going to work with is real data. It's not artificial, uniformly distributed data generated to fit a purpose. It's real, actual data that you have no control of, right? Which is freaking awesome, yes, if you ask me. So this is the challenge, to find a real, but it will take a couple of days, okay? So, look, fake and real news dataset. Let's see. So, first, what I'm asking of you is, so this type of dataset, you should save it for the next assignment, okay? But who was talking about fake news?
Why for the assignment? What does it make it so special?
Come on, you tell me. Come on, I've been blabbering about why all this whole time. Read between the lines. Why do I stress the importance of picking up a dataset that's tabular?
Well, what means tabular data?
It's in a table. Like, it's a table. It's a tabel.
Tabelar in Romana, no?
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is not, I mean, this contains text that that you will be putting. If you have long text, this is a multimedia form of information, right? So long text, novel, entire novels, whole songs, videos, and cinema, I don't know, multimedia content will be the input of the next assignment, okay? Now we're sticking to very straightforward table representation of input data. Do you agree, Brigi? Okay, so the main challenge, the first challenge, and it's an important one, is for you to find the data set, okay? So you look here, so if you like biology, let's say, you print biology, and you look for data right here. Wait, look, data set. And here, who knows what Saccharomyces cerevisiae means?
Is it some form of yeast?
Da, da, ce?
Probably the one that makes beer, maybe? I'm not sure.
Uite, baker's yeast. Drojdia, okay. Clasica.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so again, don't use this one. Because this is what? What is this? Who can tell me what this is?
Genetic information, like each one of the components of DNA. I forget their names. Each letter stands for one of them. Yeah.
What? Guanine, thymine, cytosine, and adenine, right? So yes. Yeah, again, this is a no-no, okay? Don't this. So find the data sets that contain only tables of numbers, okay? So do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Drosophila melanogaster, man. Only the names we left about in biology class when I was in fifth grade. Do you know what this is?
Musculita de oțet.
Exactly. Okay. What is this, man? I don't even know. Okay. So do you guys, are you up to the challenge?
Yes.
Oh, the classical data set. Do you know, you all know this one, right? This is Iris. Look, this is what I want, okay? This is the classical input for machine learning, right? It's one of the most famous data sets, okay? So what is this? Look, this is what I want. Tor, are you following?
Yep.
Okay. Yep. Boom, boom, boom. Paula! Ritornerò in ginocchio da me.
Scuze, am avut probleme cu net.
Ok.
Și o trebuie să restartez routerul.
Ce, bă, nu vă plătește netul bossul la lucru sau cum?
Suntem îs acasă la părinți și nu...
Glumesc, mă, e ok. Primul. Vreau să fiu rău. Lasă-l să fiu rău. Ok? So, this is the ultimate tabular data set, right? The classical one. You have IDs on the first column. You have like several measurements of sepals and petals of different species of iris. You know, this flower, the blue one. Iar când noi nu vom mai fi, vă veți aminti. Okay. And now, this... Now we're going to talk about why this column is so special, right? Who can tell me, who can analyze the column called species? Andrei.
Is it like an...
Scuze. Ești prea rapid, man. Hai să vedem și pe ceva. Okay, please analyze it. What do you see?
Percentages.
Okay. Percent, you see percentages here, right? Like iris setosa 33%, iris versicolor 33%, other 33%, right?
Yes.
Okay, so the other is virginica. Okay. So, do you think it's important that it's 33, 33 and 33 there?
Yes.
Why?
Because it should be balanced.
All right, that's where I was going to, okay? So, just pay attention to the bell. What is the species column? Do we need a column like this in our data set?
It's the weight, actually.
The what? No, what weight? Is the weight, what are you saying?
It's the origin.
No, sorry, my bad.
Is the what?
Origin issue. The
origin.
Yeah, as in...
Okay, but I mean from a machine learning perspective, this particular column, do we need it?
It's what? Like the category to which that entry belongs.
Okay, so what type of
the output.
What type of learning do we do in machine learning? We have two types.
Supervised or unsupervised.
Okay. So this is gonna be supervised, right? Because we have this column. Right, so in supervised learning, you need to have a goal. You need to have to reach for something, okay? So one column has to be known and has to be verified with respect to what you're learning, right? So the output of the machine learning has to be checked against this column for the particular instance you give it. So you take an instance from the data set. You feed it into the machine learning mechanism. It gives you out an output. And that said output is compared against what it should be obtained based on the natural data that you feed the network with. Right?
Yes.
Okay. So, this is pretty much it from the from an exterior point of view, right, Briggy? Like, you have input data, one of the columns is what is expected, and then you verify what is obtained versus what is expected, okay? We'll get there. So, this, you can, one of you, I mean, I would like for you to pick different data sets, each and every one of you, okay? So, one of you, if you like, can use this data set, but this is just what I want from your data sets, okay? Look, this site offers you viable information here on this header of the file. Do you agree? Like, what do these graphs tell us? Andrei Năpărădean.
A visualization of each...
How do you call this? What is this? This graphical
report? Graph? Statistic?
Yeah,
graph.
Yeah, but how is it called?
Bar graph.
Or? Just one name.
Bar plot?
One name.
Just bars.
Bars.
Chart.
Show me the way
charts.
To the next chart. Whiskey bar.
Bar plot?
No. Haven't you heard of a histogram?
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
How about that, right? You have beans, you have like, look, what's 4.3 and what's 7.9?
4.3 is the lowest and 7.9 is the highest value.
So it's minimum and maximum, right? So then you split the continuous interval from the minimum to the maximum into equally sized beans, right? And then you count how many entities you have in those subintervals, giving you the histogram. Easy, right? Guys?
Yes.
So how, if you remember what you have been taught in statistics...
like Gauss's bell.
Yeah.
Probably is the answer.
What type of distribution? Gauss's bell, right?
Yes.
Okay, so you have it in the first ones, but not so, I mean, ish, but not so much in the last one, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like three of those bells.
Okay, so what I want, when you choose your data sets and you present them to me, you need to let me know why you chose that one out of, I mean, if you really don't find a better one, it's okay, but you have a variety of choices here. So what I want for you to do is to find a subject that you're interested in, check if there are tabular representation of data for that particular subject, and then out of the options you have, pick the one that has the best quality of data. So it should have balanced classes. That's where you should look at, right? On the output column, on the label column, it should represent each class in an equal proportion. What if it doesn't? What do you do then?
Well, I'm not sure if this is actually okay, but you could remove some of the entries from the other categories to balance them out. But I don't think that's...
I mean that's what people do, right? And you just take some... You balance it by removing the class that has the greatest frequency, right? Removing items from that one.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what else? What can you do? Can you create... You can enhance the data with artificially generated data. How will you do that? Well, you can use these statistics, right? If the data on your column is represented based on a clear statistical distribution, right? You can generate the numbers on that column according to that distribution. But again, that's kind of bullshitty, right? Because you induce some artificially generated data within your data set. But people do that as well, you know, in order
you're
to...
You're defining balance your own facts, you know, it feels
yeah,
like...
I know, but there are some coping mechanism with the imbalance in data, in these data groups that you're trying to classify, let's say, okay? But So clearly you would like to prefer a dataset that's balanced on each class, but if you like the other aspects of the dataset, but this is a bit imbalanced, you can do what you said, like remove some of the entities and just like prune the dataset to your needs, right?
Yes.
Do you agree, Tor?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so a good idea would be to find a data set that is in a relationship with your licenza work, you know what I'm saying? I'm not saying you should do that, okay, but it would be cool. Daniel 2048, du-te, bă.
Nu eu îmi schimb.
Da, ok, numai stai, numai un pic atunci. Că azi dimineață m-am jucat, așa că I'm gonna challenge you to finish. At least, you need to prove by the end of the week that you can finish this game, okay, mate? This is the challenge. Boom!
Dacă fac până la finalul cursului, primesc un punct în plus?
La jocul ăsta, da, primești respectul meu etern.
Dar nu e așa de greu.
Cât trebuie să facem?
Nimic, man. Trebuie să fii atent la mine acum. I'm just saying. Monica? Are you okay with this first part of the assignment?
Da.
Okay. Dacă trebuie. Okay. So. Okay. Good. Is it clear so far what you have to do? Questions?
Yes.
Questions about this. Paula, ai înțeles?
Da, momentan nu am întrebări.
Ok, so we're moving forward, ok? The indicators that you need to look for are the balancing of the classes, if you have classes, because you might not have classes here, ok? Because this, what type of a problem are we facing here out of these two types of problems that we talked about? De ce am scris supervised peste clasificare sau... Ah, nu, că s-a aici. Okay.
Da, acum am văzut.
Okay, so we either have classification or regression problems, okay? Which one is it for this particular data set? And how do we know that? Clearly it's classification, because you have categorical data here on the column of the outputs. But it's not binary, is it? It's in three classes, right? You have Iris virginica, Iris versicolor, and Iris setosa, right? Three classes. Can we use one perceptron to classify between these groups? And if why, and if why not? Guys, you don't know the answer to the question, or what happened?
No, we can't.
What? Ah, no, we can't. That's the answer. Okay, thank you, guys. Andrei, right? You answered. Tell me why.
Ain't nothing but
because one perceptron can make the difference only between two categories.
Okay,
so it can say if it is part of the category or not.
True.
So we need two, I guess,
at least.
Yes,
so we need a neural network. Okay, that's where we reached, right, the other time. It's like the XOR problem, right? Splitting this data set into more than two categories is a task that cannot be fulfilled by simply one perceptron, but it can be fulfilled by a network of perceptrons, right? So let's see if we can do something about understanding the data better, okay? Let's see what we've got. What is this? Upload a file. Okay. From URL. Let's see if I can do this.
No. I think you right-clicked the... You should have maybe right-clicked the download button and copied the link from there.
Yeah. Where is that? Ah, here.
Next to the... Yeah.
This? What do you mean? This one? I mean, it gets me...
Right-click it and go copy link URL or copy link location.
Ah, okay.
And maybe it works that way. And hope it's not like a zip archive.
It's zip.
Oh, it's zipped. Yeah.
So what if I do this? I mean, I know it's the peasant way, but maybe it works. I don't know. Okay, I'm gonna do it the old school way. I'm gonna just copy the... Right? I'm gonna unzip it. Extract here. Iris. Okay. What are, man, this is like weird. So never mind the boomer, right? CSV. So it's a CSV file. Why you no work, huh? Ah, okay, got it. Okay. So you can look at the data, right, from different perspectives. Here you have different ways of plotting the form of the data, right, guys?
Yes.
Yes.
So this serves me right for trying to use a tool I've never used before, right?
Maybe there's more at the bottom of the page, like a next or something. Oh no, that's customized. Maybe double click the thing, the plot.
Yeah, maybe. Ah. Choose a chart, okay. What are you saying, bro?
Zice mai jos ceva acum.
But if you want to stack it anyway, okay. Unde?
Zice mai jos ceva de numere aici, map your dimensions.
Nu avem mai sus buton de click here sau ceva? Exact acolo unde
era. Uite, alea două steluțe probabil sunt obligatorii.
Yeah, okay. ID, sample length. Okay. So the label is clearly species, right?
Mai jos, trebuie să-l tragi.
Unde mă, aici? Ah, nu.
O mai sus acum.
Okay. Let's use two of the columns. Okay, I got it. Cool. Woo! Now we're cooking, okay? So, you can see what happens, right? Guys?
Yes, we can see the plot.
The plot thickens. So if I change this and use, I don't know, petal width, you can see that this is pretty cool, huh? You can see the nature of your data, right? This is like cutting through the n-dimensional data set you have. Do you agree with this?
Yes.
You take a pair of two columns and see the correlation, the topology of the entities with respect to the combination of those two columns, right? And also you can look with respect to what you're targeting, right? You can look for the topology of this. This is pretty cool. Do you agree? Let's see what we've got here.
It wouldn't circle packing be better, or something that just groups similar values together?
Yes, of course. Asta, nu merge cu label. Ok.
You should do, if you want it to be, you should do like one of the values and then the category instead of two columns of values.
Yeah,
you know,
you do have,
like map all of the categories to.
Hop.
And now, I think because it's a string, and it only accepts.
Yeah, true. That's what it says. Correct. So, okay. Scatter plot. Let's see what we've got here. Huh, pretty cool, right, guys? Hello?
Yeah, it's much better now.
So, clearly we have a classification problem, right? And how cool is this, right? Like, you can see that
now it's even better separation.
Exactly. You need to know your data. This is before you do anything, you know? You need to get acquainted to the data you're working with. So you have to do data analysis before you even delve into solving the problem. Do you agree? So know your data. Once this happens, after I give you green light for your data set, right? I want you to get acquainted with the data, visualize it from different perspectives. I'm gonna help you with resources for this, okay? So better websites that and better techniques for doing this. Do you agree? Do you like this? Isn't it like a bit cool?
It's nice because you can very easily select which columns to compare.
Yeah, okay, so. But the idea is that what you see now is only two columns, right? But who says that you cannot find a linear combination of columns that give you a better separation, you know? Like you have another perspective indeed in which you don't have this overlap here with between Virginica and VersiColor. You know what I'm saying? Like, maybe if you tilt it a little bit, you'll have the red ones to the left, the green ones in the middle, like clearly separated from the others. You know what I'm saying? And then the other ones. Because the idea is that not all the data in your data set are useful for what your purpose is, right? You need to find only the columns and work on only the columns that are giving you the best context for the problem of regression or classification that you are following, right? Do you agree, guys? So you know, you need to know what you're trying to do at any step of the way, which is the problem you are trying to solve, and what would be the best environment for your input data with respect to that problem, right? So this is why you need to analyze the data before you even start to solve the problem, okay? You need to prune the data, you need to like do some principal component analysis. We're gonna talk about what that means on the data and so on. So, do you like this, guys? Do you understand what happens after you submit the data set? You need to, out of all the columns, maybe out of all the columns that you have, you maybe select only the ones that will give a better performance for your task. Okay, Tor, is it clear?
Yep.
That's called data pre-processing. Okay, we have the raw data. Not all of it is. It may be correct, right? It may be, from other perspectives, very valuable. But we need to find which part of the data is valuable to help us achieve a better accuracy for our algorithms, right? Do you agree? But that it's a trick here, okay? You must not falsify the data. Guys, do you agree? Like, you cannot, like, remove the entities that you see that make your algorithm failure. Like, oh, this is a line which crosses this. I'm looking on the graphs. And, man, I have 3 points here which are misplaced. Okay, we're taking them out of the data set. That's not what you do. That's not the democratic way of solving problems, right? That's the other way. The Stalin sort way.
Oh, I was going to mention Stalin sort what you did before.
Okay. Anna?
Yes?
Is it okay with you, what we talked so far?
Yes. Yes, yes.
Okay. So once we realize that we've created a data set that's balanced, we understand the shape of the data set, we can start going into the training process of the machine learning, right? Okay, so this is where we need to have a machine learning algorithm to work with, okay? So we started, you guys remember, you were with me, the most of you, right? So we started implementing the artificial neural network the other time, right? Right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So we're going to continue to do the backpropagation because we have a seminar afterwards, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So we're going to talk about the theoretical aspects of, I don't know, research with machine learning now in the course. And then we have a small break. And then we'll continue like with the full implementation of the neural network. Are you okay with this plan for today?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So hear me out. Okay. For your task. Okay. For the homework, you can use neural networks from different frameworks already implemented. Okay. Or you can stick around and see how we implement our own. But what I want from you when we talk about it, because it will be like when you present your implementation, regardless of the fact that you used a built-in framework for devising your architecture of the neural network, or you did it on your own, you will have to tell me why you chose that many layers, why you chose those parameters, and so on. What we'll talk about the parametrization of the algorithm, okay? And I need to know that you understand the principles behind it, okay? So that's the idea. I don't emphasize the fact that you have to build it on your own, although, come on, it's fun, right, guys? The guys you were with me the other time. It gives you some sort
of... It's so cool.
It gives you some sort of satisfaction that I did that, man. I did that, you know? And also, it gives you inside the sausage, an inside the sausage look to know how the cookie was made, right? So, but the goal here is for you to understand what backpropagation is, how I implemented it, but I need you to be able to tweak your mechanism because you're in control of the problem you are trying to solve, okay? And it all starts from the data set. You need to understand the data set, the shape of the data set, the nature of the data within for progressing into training your model, okay? So when you will submit or present your homework, it will go like this. We will have a discussion on it. You will talk about the data set, you will talk about the nature of the data set, you will illustrate this conversation with some sort of you know, depictions of the why you chose some architecture, why, whatever, based on what you saw in the data, you know. So then you're gonna go and proceed and explain the architecture for a neural network, okay? So everybody should use a neural network, guys, okay?
Okay.
For either a simple classification or regression problem, okay? That's it, that's the homework, okay? You need to find the data set for that. I need to validate the data set. I'm gonna say, I'm working for you guys, okay? I'm not gonna pick very complex and very difficult data sets because that will mean more work for you, and I will recommend you use simpler data sets, okay? Because that's not the purpose of it. One, I want it to give you a sense of satisfaction that you're working on an actual data set which is from a domain that you love. Two, I want you to get behind the drapes and like figure out the mathematical and statistical mechanisms that govern the learning process of the artificial neural network, okay? And also, I would like you to bear in mind the importance of the data set, of what data represents, and how we measure at the end. This is the end points of the process, okay? At the beginning, we have data pre-processing, which we talked about, but after we create the model and we train it, we need to evaluate the performance of the model, and that's another important aspect, okay? So this is what I try to achieve with this assignment. One, data pre-processing to understand the importance of it. Two, designing a model by using a built-in framework or on your own, understanding the backpropagation mechanisms and the learning in the machine learning schemes of artificial neural networks. And then once we train the model, we need to understand how we evaluate the performance of the model using specific measurements and specific techniques to overcome how do you call it? Come on, guys. When oh man, I'm a lapsus. Over how do you call it? When a network learns something too well on the training set, but it doesn't work on the general set. Overfitting. Thank you. Okay. So how we cope with overfitting? Okay. Is it okay, guys? What do you say? What are your feelings about my goals here? Briggy?
They are very noble.
Do you think I try too hard? And to achieve too much? So Briggy, Briggy's typing. Yay.
Did you see the video about RTX voice? Gabi Mircea?
No, I don't think I have. But you can put it here.
It's like an AI that removes noise from voice calls, and it's very good.
Cool. Put it here. I mean, dudes, when you find something cool about AI and machine learning and stuff, just put it here, man, for everybody to know, you know? I'm getting bored easily. I need entertainment.
You know that Facebook bot, which people swear and, like, do crazy shit?
What?
So there was a team of researchers that created a artificial intelligence bot on Facebook.
Yeah,
and
I know. He learned how to curse, people... right?
Yeah. And
he was very racist, right? Well, come on,
yeah,
man. Come on, like, come on.
Like, people are
It's natural, like, it's, you know, like...
Yeah, it's the internet. It's Facebook.
Stefan, you know, yeah, but... I know, I like this, but this is the next step, you know, this is the deep learning end, right?
Yeah, but still, it's cool because it's, like, very efficient. I think it uses, like, 128 megabytes of RAM or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, like, live, so it's not, like, doing it on a recording.
Have you, do you know about this, The guys who faked Joe Rogan? Huh?
Maybe I know the video.
It's just they faked an audio using the one with the monkey.
Yeah, playing. Didn't they do that with Obama?
They did it with, yeah, but this, I mean, it's uncanny,
with
man.
Everyone.
Well, not everyone. They didn't do it with me, man. Yet.
Do you know the Navy SEAL copypasta?
I don't
it's know. Like a text about a guy that's like, I'm the best Navy SEAL in the world, I'm gonna... Some guy is raging at a kid on a game, but it's like a text. Someone made an AI that analyzed the way Jay-Z raps, and made an AI that raps that text in his style, and it sounds so like him, it's creepy.
Cool. I know, it's creepy, man. That's the definition. We're doing creepy shit here, okay?
Uncanny Valley territory, you know?
Yeah, man, it's a moral gray area with this AI stuff. We're gonna get to that when we conclude our... I mean, I know it will be important at the end of this class, man. We're gonna talk seriously about the moral implication of all this and where the limit is. I mean, I really like to know your opinion on this. But we have a long way till then. Okay.
Well, morality is... It depends on the person when it comes to AI. So, you know, there
know,
was
man,
like AI that in augmented reality would mimic the relatives of the dead relatives of someone.
Yeah, I've seen
and
that
you could...
one. Yeah, it's kind of. It's,
that's
it's...
fucking sad. That's not okay.
I know, man. I know. But let's get back to what we have to do, okay? We'll talk about it, guys. I mean, we can talk a week about this stuff, I mean, a whole year, but let's focus, okay? Cool. Do you agree? Sorry for cutting you off, man. I like to talk about this stuff, but we have beeswax to do. So where were we?
I will forever resent you.
I'm sorry? John?
I will forever resent you.
Resent me?
Yeah.
Meh. You do already do that, right? I mean...
No.
So, Briggy, about your response about expectations. Yeah, well, it's kind of my philosophy of not having expectations. So, you're already exceeding them. Cool. So, is it clear so far? Can we move along the way?
Yes.
Okay. So.
And also, it would be okay if you had like a.
What?
Message / post about the requirements so people don't forget
yeah,
or
yeah,
have them
okay.
Written down somewhere. You know?
I'll do that. Okay. Cool. What about, let's see, I mean, maybe we should talk about the performance assessment now, okay? Because, do you agree with this plan? We talk about what happens before the actual training, then what happens after, and then we delve into the black box. How about that? Guys.
Yes.
Okay, because if we get this out of the way, now I think it's clear to anybody what goes into a machine learning algorithm, right? Guys? Other people that don't say anything, anytime, anywhere, any place. Who there? Let's talk to somebody else.
Anyhow.
Andrea, we haven't spoken in a while. Are you with us?
Yes.
Okay. So, is it clear what you have to do to look for a data set?
Yes.
Okay. So, let's say we found our data set. And now we train the model. How do I know how good this trained model is? You know?
Well, I think we should give it some data that wasn't in the set and see, but that we know the result of, and see how good it gets it, how well it gets it.
Do you agree, Andrea?
Yes.
So how am I going to do that? How much of this data set will be used for training and how much will be used for... So I need to split it, right? Into two sets first, right? We'll have the...
The training and the control or something like
that. Let's just fit like training. Yeah, you make it sound like a very Nazi experiment here with the control. That...
Why? It's just how science works.
Yeah, I know, man. But every time you say like control, I think about epidemics. I don't know, the guys in the control set. I don't know. It's just like, it's just me, man. I'm sorry. Don't you think about that type of, I mean, it gets me depressed when I hear about the control set or something like that. Guys, Thor, what do you say? Am I weird?
No, it's because of Stefan.
I don't know about that.
So I have to split it into a training set and what? Let's call it testing set, okay? How much will I use for the training part and how much for the testing part? Anna.
Yes.
I'm sorry?
What was the question again?
The question again was how much will I use from my initial data set to put in the training set and how much will I put in the testing set?
The number.
What are you...
The golden rule.
The golden rule. So sorry. Why are you acting like a bloody fool?
I don't know.
So, okay, quick history lesson, guys. The golden rule, man. Like, who knows about the 80-20 rule?
Me. Who's me?
So, how 80, about 80. This guy? Have you heard about this guy?
Yes.
Who was this guy? Look, this beardy little Italian fellow. Vilfredo Pareto. Who that? Does this name ring any bells?
Fortunately, no.
Yes.
Fortunately, no. Okay. So this guy was kind of cool, man. Right? Who said yes? Can you tell us a little bit about this guy?
No.
Why not?
Because okay. I don't know that much.
Okay, but you know. Okay. So what this guy did? He lived at the. I mean. In the 19th century, right? And now he conducted some research, right? And he was a bit... his findings were used by Benito... Do you know who Benito Mussolini was, right? Guys?
Yeah.
No.
Thor, do you know who the guy was?
Benito Mussolini.
Vezi că te auzi foarte...
Dai pace.
Ok. Cine nu... Andrea.
What?
Cine a fost Benito Mussolini?
I don't know.
Pilot de Formula 1.
If you know your history, then you know where you're coming from. But if you don't...
Ceva ministru de externe al Italiei?
A fost prim-ministru italian în timpul celui de-al doilea război mondial.
Menuț, AXA,
a fost un dictator.
AXA Berlin, Roma, Tokyo, nu vă spune nimic?
Nope.
What? Bă,
what
bă,
do you
bă,
mean?
Bă! Okay,
how to
okay.
Trigger people, one of...
Uai, frate, ok, man. Ok, deci mareșalul ăla a întors armele și vă nu știți nici cu cine, contra cui, nu știu... Ok, ok, I'm cool, I'm ok. Ok, so, the context was... Ok, hai că divagăm de la chestia, că nu asta vreau, dar... Uf, that's a can of worms I'm not gonna open again, man. Shit. Ok, so, this guy was a sociologist, economist, political scientist and philosopher. Ok, so what he did that was so cool, it was that he took a lot of books of depicting the wealth of separate communities from Western Europe, okay? And he tried to see if there is a principle that guides or, I don't know, governs the human wealth within societies. And do you know what he found?
That there is one.
Yeah, regardless of the societies, you know, like if it was Prussia or France or Italy or whatever, Western Europe, all communities were governed by the same rule, that 80% of the wealth of the population was held by 20% of the population. Okay? This 80-20 rule. You know? Do you understand?
Yes.
So, the idea, I mean, the idea that the fascists used in their propaganda and stuff like that was, and this is like, it's not wrong, that every time this balance was broken at the global scale, you had very great wars in Europe to try to re-establish the balance. It's pretty weird, right?
So, broken, but like both ways. So, for example, if there weren't enough rich people, there would be a war. And if there were too many rich people, there would be a war.
Exactly, exactly. Because you can see how a world war... was a consequence, the world wars were a consequence of the fall of royalty, which was determined by the French Revolution and so on, right? So it's exactly what you're saying. You have no more rich people to sell your diamonds to and stuff like that, and who can, and you need to rebalance the power. That's what it's all about, right? With the 80-20 rule. So the idea is that this Pareto principle is very important in economics, right? So do you know another guy who is like very important, whose findings were very important in economics? How about the guy called John Nash?
You know? Didn't he win the medal or something?
Yeah, he did. But why? What was his contribution to
science? There's a movie about him.
Of course, A Beautiful Mind. Did you guys see
A Beautiful Mind?
Thor, did you see it?
Can you guess my answer?
I hope I don't guess it. I mean, you haven't seen A Beautiful
Mind. Yeah.
Whoa, okay. Man, okay. Alright, but see it, okay, guys? I mean, you cannot finish, like, a computer science college and you haven't seen that movie. It's like you haven't seen... I don't know, Good Will Hunting.
Have you seen what now?
Good Will Hunting. You haven't seen, guys? Oh my god. Okay, whatever.
I have.
Okay. No more. I said I won't talk about movies. I won't talk about movies, okay? The idea was that this guy and the Pareto equilibrium holds, okay? And it holds in a lot of physical systems, mathematical systems, in multi-criterial optimization, it's very important, and so on, okay? But what I was trying to say is that he issued this 80-20 rule. So we're gonna, I don't know, use that one. Do you agree? Andrea, I was talking to you about this topic.
What was the question?
If you agree that we should split it 80-20 according to this rule. Huh?
Yes.
Okay, so please, if you want to look more into this, okay? This is so cool, man. Right? This is so cool. I mean, it literally holds. Unbelievable. Okay, so... if you want to look more into this, I mean, I find it fascinating. When I read first about this guy, I was like, holy smokes, man. He was in the 19th century, right? He was like, you know, he was living in the same age as Eminescu, right? Pretty cool guys. Okay. So, Andrea, moving on. I take 80% Are you following?
Yes.
Of the initial data set and put it for training, and then the other ones I put aside for to test at the end, right? So how will this training proceed, guys? How am I gonna do the training of my model?
Like, what do you mean? We're gonna send the entries through the model and
okay,
see if what comes out.
Okay, how many entries? One by one? Let's send it one by one. I take one instance, I feed it as input to the machine learning algorithm, it gives me up an answer. The answer is somewhat wrong. We have an error. We backpropagate the error so that it doesn't appear for that particular instance, and boom, we repeat the process, right?
No, I think we have to do it for all of the data, right?
Okay. Only once?
No, until we get good results.
Okay.
Like, yes.
You can keep doing it forever, I think, and forever. But you have to be careful of what you are saying with overfitting or something.
Yeah, okay. So the idea is that I'm going to iterate through this training set more than once, right? Train
yes.
It more than once, right? Okay, so.
I think so. It will make sense this
yeah,
way.
Yeah, of course. The iteration, one iteration is called an epoch, right?
Okay.
So let's say I have one epoch of iterating through the training set, okay? But even if I go through the training set once, right? I need to have a measure of how this thing progresses in learning, right? So if I can compare my machine learning algorithm to a toddler, right? Who's trying to learn the ABCs of life, okay? How am I gonna supervisedly train this little guy in school? Like you were the little guy, you are the machine learning algorithm.
You're gonna grade it somehow.
Yeah, but... Exactly. I like the fact that we're getting here, man, because this is at the basis of my philosophy about school. So, yes, you need to understand how well the poor fellow has learned, right? That's the grade right there. The grade is only an indicative of how well the guy, the student has learned, right? That's all it is. It doesn't show him the value of the student, right? Do you agree with
yes.
this?
Yes, you are right.
It's just a measure of the training process. Of
or rather
student.
The measure of interest.
So,
you know?
So yeah, it can. You can view it as a good thing and as a bad thing, because as a bad thing is that it will only tell you how well prepared is the student to learn the data that you've been providing him so far, right?
Well, I think you also have to keep in mind something like something related to the errors. So how many errors
okay.
does he make before
yeah.
reaching something? Because you can be very good
okay.
at doing 1+1, but then I tell you to do 1+2 and you're
exactly.
lost, you know?
So you need to know your audience as a teacher, right? So you cannot rush things only because you have a schedule if, let's say, the student lags behind. And that is why, from time to time, you need to give them some examinations, some just like temporary examinations to see how well did he learn this small chapter, right? Do you agree with this?
Yes, like a partial exam.
Yeah, exactly. Like a partial exam or like the... I don't know, impromptu quizzes you had and you hated so much, like Squatted Sofia de Hirtie type of thing, right?
Oh, we still do. It's not a thing in the past. It's a...
Yeah, I know. It never ends, so to speak, right? So...
You did it as well.
I know, man. And you hated it as well. Booyah.
And you...
And come on, it worked, okay? You have to admit that worked, man. Thank heavens that I did that, okay?
So, yeah, it was really nice, but in schools they actually grade you for that, and that's the shitty
move. I know, but I don't. Do you understand? So that is why I like that we reached that topic, because the grade is. So what if it grades you? The grade is just a temporary measure of your accuracy right now, and the parents shouldn't be fussing about it. The teachers should understand what it means, and also the students. Okay. If all these three parties understand what a grade actually is, then we can make all this mechanism to actually learn something. If not, if you put pressure on the student to just get the grade, then you just like devoid the whole concept of its importance, okay? If you're a parent and you press your offspring to learn for the grade, that's bullshit. If you're a teacher who doesn't really get what goes on there, and he's like pressured by the ministry or something to achieve some quantifiable grade averages and stuff like that, again, doesn't really understand what the grade means, okay? And also, the geeky, wannabe, I don't know, straight A student, again, doesn't understand the concept of a grade, okay? So, if you look at this at schooling and learning and all that as a machine learning endeavor, you will really understand what needs to be done, man. Because what we do in this supervised learning mechanism, which is school for the masses, is exactly that. Do you have to agree that it's a clear parallel here? Do you agree?
Well, it makes sense, because initially the purpose of school was to create people that could work in factories, and creates people that can follow instructions and do the same task over and over, really. You know, it's not about creative things.
But on the other hand, you cannot tell, I mean, they don't live anymore, so you cannot tell them physically, but you couldn't tell my grandparents that it wasn't a cool thing to be able to read and write, man. Not like their parents and great parents, okay?
Yes,
you
of course,
haven't seen my grandfather like crying while reading a Eminescu poetry, or my grandma as well reading some novel written like about the peasant life that reminded her of her own experience and stuff like that. Like, that's a huge leap forward, you know, and it was all done by this crappy school system that was implemented by whom in Romania? Do you know who started the first schools and universities in modern Romania?
I knew, but I've forgotten.
So his name kind of sounds Japanese crime organization. Yes, Yakuza. Alexandru Ion Cuza. Right?
Yes. Yeah, so, the first university in, yes.
Okay, nu mă bag acolo, că aia cred că e mai personal pentru tine, nu? Ești de pe acolo, bă?
Da, eu am fost la Cuza.
Good, that's cool.
Și-am uitat.
Yeah, it's okay. So, I'm gonna repeat this, man. What Bob Marley says, if you know your history, then you know where you're coming from. And this is why I'm appalled by the lack of historical knowledge in you guys. I'm sorry, I have to say it. I mean, I'm frightened for the future of mankind. You know, I don't.
So you had higher expectations?
Man, it's not about expectations. No, it's not about expectations, man. But shit, I mean, if I'm gonna ask you, it's gonna be like 80% of you hated history as a subject in school, and that I don't. I mean, maybe I understand it.
I hated the teachers.
Yeah, whatever.
Like the
so
teachers.
It's all okay. So let's finish with this theoretical stuff, so we can have a break and then delve into the training process. Okay, Andrea.
Yes.
So somehow I need to within this epoch of training, I need to split the training process into sub steps and check if the learning goes okay along the way, right?
Yes.
How do I do that? Guys, like I don't know. You
have to test it somehow during the the...
Ok, bine, bine. Ok, no, bine. No, bine. No, spor. Management de proiect, cu cine? Scuze, nu mă pic. Ah, bine, bine. Ok. Pa, 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 pa. Dacă trebuie să fac... Ah, scuze că stai pe cameră, vă zic după aia. Let's go. So, Andreea.
Yes.
How would you do it? So, you start the training set, you put some instances into the machine learning algorithm, you backpropagate the error for them, and then what? How do you test if this model works? So it's like, this is your student, the machine learning mechanism, and then you give it a problem to solve, he gives a bad example, a bad result, you just called him, you modify its weights, he said you should have put that here, that here, that here. He's like, oh yeah, I get it for this case. And now the next time he does it, he will know for that particular type of problem how to solve it. Then you take another... Cum? What?
I think someone walked in
my...
on her.
Ah, okay, sorry.
Yeah, it was my brother.
Ah, cool. So, then you give it another type of exercise. Again, he doesn't do it perfectly right. And then you have to teach him again how to do it properly. And then you want to know if all this teaching done so far is going in the right direction, right? How do you do that?
By using the testing set.
Okay, but you don't want to hit him hard, right? You don't want to frighten the poor fellow, like giving him something that he hasn't seen before. That's for the tese, you know what I'm saying? That's when you hit them hard in the end. It's like, you know, you play a game, like the princess is not in this castle, you know what I'm saying? You haven't met the boss yet.
Yeah, yeah. So do you check with the like past entries and see if the results don't change or something like that?
Yeah, but that would mean that you lead to, you tend to have a generation of fucking nerds. Sorry for the nerds part. So, like... Because they're overfitting, okay? So what is overfitting? Overfitting means that you are a robot that has no ability to generalize what he learned, okay? He works perfectly on the data set that he, on the typical problems that he was trained on, but that's it. When he has to, like, find patterns, generic patterns that will solve similar type of problems, cannot do it. Like, cum se numește asta acum? Cum e acum de să tot bată ăștia cu... funcțională aia, analfabetism funcțional. You don't want to generate a machine learning who's like illiterate, functionally illiterate, right? Do you understand? That's overfitting.
Yes.
So it's that student who is a straight A student but doesn't make it in the real life. Have you seen that pattern? And
yes.
It's not his fault, man. That he's a victim, or she, or whatever he identifies with. But I cry for that individual, okay? Because the disappointment that you have after 2 decades of schooling, man. And the realization that you are not fit to the environment. I mean, it has to be like mind-blowing and heartbreaking, okay? So it's bullshit because it's a result of the system and not of the individual, okay? And since individuals have to obey the system, there is where it's leading. But I don't know. If we understand the process of schooling and learning and all that, and we can, after we understand, you know, do you understand how important it is to understand what everything is all about, man? Like, how can we go like monkeys running on fumes based on the status quo and just like 10 years passed already, another 10 years passed? Why do you do the things that you do? I don't know. Everybody does that. I don't want that from you guys. Okay? I don't want that from you with this assignment, and I don't want that from you with life. You know what I'm saying? Like, look around, try to understand the data set that you are being given, aka life, okay? Understand it first and then tackle it. Not just like, I don't know, run some machine learning implemented by others because it's easy. And this is metaphor for life, okay? I'm not talking about actual schoolwork, okay? I don't know. So you shouldn't just give them the exact type of exercises that he had, and also you shouldn't give them just the very new, never heard of before exercises. But what should you do instead?
Can we split that training set again?
Haha, maybe we can go back and split it properly from the beginning. How about that? I mean, at each, what if I, after I perform, let's say I have a training step here within the epoch, and then after this step, I take some part of the training set and some part of the testing set and form what? What am I doing with this?
A control set.
Okay, it's called a validation set, right? Do you agree?
Yes.
Does it make sense? I mean, you give him some, proper teacher should do this as well while teaching first grade, second grade, fifth grade, you name it, okay? In order to see the balance between the theoretical part and the ability to generalize the theoretical part, you need to give some safety points, okay, some safety items in the text, and also to take the student out of their safe box with some exercises that test their generalization abilities. Do you agree with this? Like, let's say, I don't know, you taught them how to add numbers with only one digit, and then you slip in a two digit with one digit exercise or something, just to see who isn't afraid to generalize the process, right? Do you agree? I mean, not everybody should get an A. Guys, what do you say about this? Do you understand?
Yes, it makes sense.
Thor?
It makes sense.
Not really.
What do you mean?
Well, you kind of lost.
When?
After the validation set, and then you said you gave an example of school again, and not everybody should get a 10. I don't get the correlation.
Well, I'm saying that not all the students will be able to generalize what they are being taught, you know, at the beginning. That's a skill that needs to be acquired. So that's why you need not pressure students to get good grades all the time, because at some point maybe you take a longer time than your fellow student to pick up a skill, right? And that's nothing to be shamed about, in my opinion. Everybody
well, it's normal, because like has everyone has different skills.
Exactly.
Yeah. But different skills.
I know, but on the other hand, you cannot teach any single soul separately, because in this day and age, like, you need to standardize stuff, okay? I mean, the main problem here is that institutionalized schools have to sacrifice some of the students for the well-being of the most students, I guess. I don't know.
For the greater good.
But what is the greater good? Because this is the question. Like, the way in college, right? Like, my question regarding how to teach you guys. I have three levels at which I can teach. Like, to pick everybody by the hand and teach at the lowest level possible and take everybody with me and rise all the class as much as I can, okay? But then the guys who already know some stuff and the guys who are Olympics and stuff like that, they will be like all up on my case. Why are we doing some shitty little stuff? Okay, so then I try to please the medium level, right? In which that means that some students that I don't know what this, nobody is stupid, man. I hate it when students say that, oh my god, I'm so stupid. That is bull wax, okay? Because you're not. You had the bad luck of not being properly trained so far, but you can pick it up, man. Okay? So what if we have only 4 weeks left? We can still improve our knowledge of computer science big time, okay? Time is relative, okay? So what I'm saying is, if I try to focus on the medium level, then there will be guys who will be frightened by the subject because they are not as well trained as the average students, okay? And still the guys who are in Olympiads and say it will be like it's a boring subject, whatever, we should have done something more interesting and so on. But I'm pleasing the average. If I go up, I please the few, I don't know, Olympians, then everybody's up on my case, okay? So the idea is that somehow there is a flaw in this scheme, because no matter what I'm doing, somebody is gonna be upset. So what do you think we should do?
I think go for the middle ground. I don't know. Feels like usually the right answer is somewhere in the middle.
I know.
I'd rather separate the courses on
Thank
level.
You. Yeah, that would be
like
the
American,
American
system.
Yeah,
I
yeah. I'm always thinking about that, yes. But you cannot do that because you'll have to like re-implement the whole shebang. You know, you need. How do you do it going along, reforming it as you go along? Because it's kind of impossible to change it everything from the basis of it, right?
I think I have a solution, or at least the way it was done.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, I can.
Sorry.
You know the Dutch model or something
the,
else? You have
the
a
Dutch. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This, yeah, a certain set of credits. No.
El a mers în, unde o supărare a mers? În Suedia sau nu știu pe unde a mers. Yeah, I know, but...
Daci Olanda.
Da, mă știu. I know, man.
Deasupra Belgiei.
Man, can you afford to be condescending after you didn't know who Benito Mussolini was, man? Like, seriously. Like,
ignorance is a bliss.
Ok, so, vorbim imediat. Numai hai să terminăm cu chestia asta ca să încheiem cursul, ok? Guys, so,
da.
The idea was that after a training session within the epoch, how many instances will I take for this intermediate session here? I'm gonna take them in batches. Okay,
and how much is a batch? Like I thought you were gonna say a number or something.
Well, you take a percent. I mean, you split the data set into equally sized, I mean, 10% slices or 20% slices, and you just you train on 10%. You know what I'm saying?
And does the size of the slice have an impact on overall accuracy? Or
well, yeah, I'm struggling with a classifier right now, and I guess that is the problem. I mean, was not doing well, and then I realized that in one of the configuration files I gave the batch size to 2 because I'm a moron, because it flooded my GPU, and then I forgot. I was like, man, maybe if I put a smaller value there it wouldn't flood my GPU. Then I solved the problem with the GPU and the value remained the same there, and after like a day of bad results qualitatively, I was like, holy smokes, let's check the configuration files. And I was like, why is that 2 right there, you know? So yeah, the batch size can influence, you know, the performance of the... You can see why, right? If you want to train the student to find correlations between a batch of similar or, I don't know, or various, maybe not similar, but the opposite, varied examples, you will like to have a rather a greater than smaller batch or something. Okay, a smaller batch, yeah, it will impact the accuracy of the process. Do you agree?
Yeah, okay, it makes sense.
But also, if you put too big a batch, it will lead to a slow learning process, and maybe you shouldn't. There's, as you said, it's a balance, right? Karina? Karina? Are you with us?
She wrote in the chat.
Ah, okay. Somebody who can talk to us. Daniel!
Yes.
Okay. Can you help me summarize what we talked about? So, we have a data set, right? Which is a table of data. The lines are instances, the columns are attributes. We have one specific or a set of specific columns that are usually categorical for classification purposes and continuous for regression purposes. We're going to talk about regression as well, right?
Yes.
Now, we split this data set into, let's say, following the 80-20 rule, a separate training set and a testing set, and we can find a validation set which takes both items from the training and the testing set for our validation purposes. Did you follow so far?
Yes.
Does it make sense?
Yes.
Then we take a batch of instances and we do this. We train the learning model for that particular batch of instances. But after we do this, we need that quiz, right? We need to perform the validation. So what we do, we need to find some measures of how well it behaves on this validation set. Is anybody okay? Everybody okay with this?
Yeah.
Yes.
So what are these measurements? What is the most important measurements for machine learning's mechanisms, accuracy and stuff? Well, accuracy for the beginning, right?
Well, yes.
Okay, so if I'm gonna take a classification problem, and let's take a binary classification problem, right? So what's a binary classification problem? It means that I have some points, you've seen the points, right? I have some points which are red points, right? And I have some other points which are blue points. And then I have like this line classification right here, right, guys? What are the four groups of points that are generated? I have these blue points from here. Okay, let's.
Is it like points that are on in the right category?
Okay.
So that's two groups, so the blue and the red. Then red points that are on the blue side and blue points that are on the red side.
Do you agree? Yeah, guys. Tor.
So this is for classification.
I'm sorry?
I don't.
What?
Get it.
Well, what is classification? We talked about classification with the perceptron, right? You have the data points and you need to find the equation of a line that linearly splits the subplanes underneath and above the graph of the line, so that on the one side of the line you have only blue points if possible, and on the other hand you have only red points, right? Yo.
Right.
Okay, but clearly a line cannot separate these non-linearly separable You know, because you wrote that, because it has to be linearly
separate. Yeah.
Okay. So that means...
Then we made a curve.
Yeah, you need... But let's see. Let's say I have only one perceptron, right? How do I know, how do I measure how well this perceptron works for this particular set of points, right? For my data set. In order to see how well it performs, I need to measure some statistics, right? So the number, I have a number of what? True positives, right? So considering that blue is the positive set and red is the negative set, the blues that are correctly characterized as blue are the true positives, right?
Yeah.
Then the reds that are correctly classified as reds are the true negatives, okay?
Yeah.
So what are these blues that are characterized
false as positives?
What? Why would they be positives?
False.
Well, they're negative false because negatives. This is the class of okay. negatives. This is the class of positives, yes. Right? So false negatives, right? Do you agree?
Right.
And these guys here, they're the false positives, right? So let's, right. Okay, let's take the very, I don't know, it's a cringe example, but it's very illustrative. So for the pandemics, right? They do the test, which is the worst case?
You got false negatives.
So these guys, these guys, right? The false negatives. Because these are put in the class of negatives, and in fact, they're not. Do you agree, Tor?
Yeah.
This is exactly what they are doing. If you look at life, it's a classification. That's what they're doing now. Okay? They take the DNA, they like shake it really well there, and then they figure out based on some whatever science mechanisms, right? If you're above or below the line, correct?
Yeah.
Yes. Broadly.
So, yeah, bluntly even. So, you can see that, I don't know, we can, as I always said, you don't learn computer science for the sake of computer science. You learn the art of properly solving real life problems, okay? So we can apply what we learn here to our own intelligence, right? We can apply rules that we find in artificial intelligence to the way we teach our youth, right? Which is pretty cool in my point of view, okay? Because this is what happens in reality as well. So based on these measurements, true positives, false positives, true negatives, false negatives, you can create better statistics that give you the performance of your algorithm, okay? So let's see. Accuracy, precision, recall. Okay, do you know this? Have you heard, Briggy? Do you know? Did you use this? Okay, so
how... I know about it from first-person shooter games. yeah, because they do it in the same way. So you know, grouping and stuff.
Uh-huh. Yeah, cool. See, it's important, man. You learn. I mean, yeah, it's cool. You learn outside school as well. Scuola vieți, băiat. Correct. So look at this. Like, the precision, recall, and accuracy can be defined based on these numbers. Okay, so. You realize that you don't do anything special here. You just count how many, because you know which are blue and which are red, right? If you're not a colorblind individual like myself. Anna.
Yes.
Are you following?
Yes.
Okay, so the idea is that Having these, you can figure out the precision, okay? You see, it's the same idea here. You have the true positives, false positives. These are the false. I mean, this one, they put them. How did they put them? Ah, the negatives are up there. Yeah, it's cool. Okay. So now it says that the precision depicts how many selected items are relevant, okay? Which means that you take the true positives out of all the class that you wanted to do for the binary classification, right? The positives, right? So it's the true positives over all the positives. Do you agree? How precise you were in your endeavor to select the positives, okay? So it has only to do with the positives, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Do you guys understand, Tor?
Yeah.
Okay. So, the recall, however, is how many relevant items are selected. So, this contains what? What is this? False negatives and true positives. These are, in fact, the guys you should have categorized as what?
As being part of the category.
I mean, what if you... If your circle only contains the black guys, you have, right, only relevant, you've selected all the relevance and you didn't leave any of the relevance outside, right? So the recall is the number of the positives you managed to classify as positive with respect to all the actual positive, all the class of actual positives, right? Of relevant elements, so to speak, because the positive is something that it's arbitrary and you establish, right? So is it clear? This is with respect to what you chose. This is with respect to what it actually is and should have been perfect, right?
Yes.
Tor?
Yeah.
Okay, so what would be the accuracy? How will I...
Formula? A formula with precision and recall?
Yeah, but what is the accuracy?
I think it was a bit above.
Yeah, sorry. Where was it? Was it?
Precision. Oh.
No, it was...
Maybe search for it, like Control F.
Yeah, but that's, I don't know. Let's see.
Are we taking the break?
Yeah. We're taking a break in 4 minutes, okay? So, yeah, look. The accuracy is kind of straightforward, right? Hmm?
Yeah.
So...
It's the good cases over all the cases.
Yeah, so it doesn't matter if you have the established positive and negative. It's what was good and you classified as good and what was bad and you classified as bad over the all the cases. Like, goes without saying, right? Do you agree?
Yeah.
Cool. What do we have here? Yeah, so... This is cool.
But aren't there some more complex formulas for accuracy?
For accuracy?
Naive Bayes or something.
Oh, okay. Yeah, but I'm talking about the... Okay, we haven't reached that level yet. Come on, man. Okay. We're talking about the simple stuff. And we get to the more complicated stuff, right? Okay? Guys, is it okay?
Yes.
Okay, so... You got this, right? How about, this is for classification purposes, right? How about regression? We didn't talk anything about regression, okay? But we're gonna talk about, we're gonna continue after the with the implementation after the small break. Okay, guys. Cine mai vrea?
Okay.
No, bun. Mă duc să-mi fac și o niște o travă. So, did you guys enjoy what we talked about?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Andreea?
Yes.
Alexandra, tu ne-am prea vorbit. Ai urmărit ce-am vorbit pe aici?
Noi mergem.
Ok. Rob, ce? Ai plecat la un moment dat. Te-ai întors?
Da, nu m-au...
Ba da.
Am zis acum, că am înțeles.
Ah, ok. Ai plecat, ai venit, n-a vrut nimeni să te țină.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Hmm? Ce zici?
Am zis că îmi cer scuze.
Ah, glumeam, bă, dar mă gândeam la vița, știi? Nu pot să cred că ai cântat. Nu înțeleg. Nici măcar n-ai încercat. Mamă, ce voce n-am. Monica? Ce poți să-mi zici despre ce am vorbit?
Ok.
Deci vreau să-mi căutați și să-mi trimite, deci pe grupul ăsta vreau să-mi puneți propunerile de dataset-uri, ok?
Ok, dar până când?
Cum adică okay. Până când? Păi v-am zis că deadline-ul de termina cu totul e peste 2 săptămâni.
Da, depus dataset-urile.
Ce nu există deadline la depus dataset-uri? Gen,
okay.
Deadline-ul la tot proiectul. Perfect, Andreea, i-ai bușit pe toți ceilalți, îți dau ție ăla cu Iris. Ha! Pentru restul. Bine. Ballsy move. Nice. Ia-l tău. Damn, you good. Nu m-am așteptat la asta. Da, deci, băi, eu sunt pe principiu că dacă vrei să gestionezi timpul corect, ți-l gestionezi, nu trebuie să ți-l gestionezi eu. Știi? Adică tu știi, dacă poți să-l faci în ultima noapte, îl faci în ultima noapte. Îmi pui la ora 11 dataset-ul înainte de deadline, eu zic că e bine. Și gen, după aceea toată noaptea bagi un all-nighter și țâp să meargă. A doua zi dimineață, dacă știi tot ce merge pe acolo, ai bușit-o frumos, studențește, n-am nicio treabă. E treaba ta dacă vrei să faci așa, știi? Dar, no, deci eu ți-am zis, deadline-ul 2 weeks. Ok?
Yeah. Da.
Broscheașul?
Da. Bă, ok, îmi place, am auzit.
Da?
Sunt de acord.
Ok? Bine. Carina? Ok. Zile lor, Dana. Ok. Feedback, aveți să-mi ziceți. E mai clar un pic ce înseamnă machine learning-ul, cât de cât. Cu ce ne ocupăm pe aici? Sau dacă aveți întrebări, spuneți-le ceva dacă nu e clar.
E ok, eu zic că e explicat așa foarte bine, știi, și de originele chestiilor și așa e. Important să știi de unde vin lucrurile și de ce se fac așa.
Da, asta zic că, mă, odată ce you learn the fundamental, după aia, da, poți să folosești tool-uri și chestii, dar nu dacă nu știi ce-i sub capotul, știi? Daniel, băiețel, cum ești?
Mi-a plăcut.
Ok. No, hai că opresc...
Mai vii și data viitoare, nu?
Hai că opresc un pic ăsta.